Let's take two aqueous solutions. One of them is sucrose and one of them sodium chloride. They're both the same concentration, 0.01 molal. And we go do the experiment, and we figure out the freezing points for them. So the sucrose freezes at this temperature. Well, up until this point, your expectation should be that the sodium chloride solution freezes at the same temperature. Colligative properties are dependent upon how many particles you have dissolved and not what the particles are. And then you see this. It's like, wait a minute, they're the same concentration. Well, there is a particle issue going on here. That's what we're looking at in this podcast. In order to understand the difference in the freezing points, you have to understand what's happening when these compounds dissolve. What happens when sucrose dissolves? What happens when sodium chloride dissolves? If you can explain that, you can explain the freezing point differences. Well, sucrose is a molecule, and when you dissolve it, you get sucrose molecules. Sodium chloride is an ionic compound, and when you dissolve it, it breaks up into sodium ions and chloride ions. See, this is not a solubility issue between these two. You know these two are soluble because you've done it. This is an issue of what do they do once they're in solution. And then compare those freezing points. Now, you know that water freezes at 0 degrees Celsius. So the delta T for each of these, look, what's the delta T of sodium chloride compared to sucrose? It appears to be twice that of sucrose. For the sucrose solution, for every sucrose, you get one dissolved sucrose. For sodium chloride, for every one sodium chloride, you get two ions. That's the difference here. We've been dealing with non-electrolytes up until this point. Now we're throwing electrolytes into the mix. Now we need to know how much, to what degree they're dissociating. All right. We'll go do the experiment, measure the new freezing point, get a delta T. Then, do what we did before. Walk through the calculation. When you do it, assume the solute's a non-electrolyte. Whether it is or it isn't, assume it's a non-electrolyte. Now the expectation is that the delta T experimental is going to be at least as big as the delta T calculated. And we can do something with that. We can take the experimental change in temperature and divide it by the calculated change in temperature, and we're going to call that our Van 't Hoff factor, letter I. It's named after the Dutch chemist Jacobus Henricus Van 't Hoff. He was winner of the first Nobel Prize in chemistry in 1901, and quoting from the Nobel Prize website, it was in recognition of the extraordinary services he has rendered by the discovery of the laws of chemical dynamics and osmotic pressure in solutions. I'm going to take four different solutes, each of them at three different concentrations, 0.1, 0.01, 0.001 molal. And I'm going to show you what the value of I is for each of these. Well, sucrose is a non-electrolyte, so the delta T experimental should be the same as the delta T calculated, at least that's what you expect. And regardless of whether it's 0.1 or 0.01 or 0.001, that I value is the same, which means the delta T experimental is the same as delta T calculated. Now the limiting value, what are these values approaching? Well, they're approaching 1. Let's look at sodium chloride. And that I value is 1.87. Let's look at the next solution. And look, As it goes from 0.1 to 0.01, the value of I goes up, which means the experimental delta T is increasing compared to the calculating delta T, and that's not expected. The expectation is if you put more stuff in solution, that you have a bigger effect, right? Look what happens with the 0.001. What are these three values approaching? How many ions are in sodium chloride? Sodium ion chloride ion, right? They're approaching 2. They're approaching the number of ions in solution. Okay, so the limiting value is 1 if it's a non-electrolyte. If it's an electrolyte, it's equal to the number of expected ions. So if it's an ionic compound, it's just how many cations or anions. And anions are in there. Sodium chloride 2. But what's going on with the concentration effect? Let's take a water molecule. You go back to Chem 1, intermolecular forces. Water has a bent shape, has a very strong dipole, and you get this partially negative and partially positive ends of the water molecule. So then you throw in sodium chloride. We'll just look at the sodium ion first. Well, the sodium ion's positive, and what it does is it reorients the water molecules around it. So you get the partially negative end of the water molecules pointing towards the sodium ion. And you get an analogous effect for the chloride ion and water molecules. So with a bunch of these in solution, you get shells of water molecules around them. So a thought experiment. Take the classroom. Throw everybody out. Take all the chairs and tables out. Then, pick two people. One's a cation, one's an anion. Blindfold them. Give them earplugs so they can't hear. Put them in random areas in the room. Spin them around. And let them start walking around. Well, the probability of them bumping into each other, in other words, being attracted to each other, is relatively low because you only got one of each in there. So that's analogous to a low concentration solution. But now, put in a bunch of cations and a bunch of anions in solution. So in here, I've got 4 of each for a total of 8. So you take all those people, you blindfold them, put earplugs in, spin them around, randomly put them in the room, and then turn them loose. Since it's more crowded, you have a higher probability of people being attracted to each other, and you'll bump into each other. And if it's a cation getting close to an anion, they can attract each other. So if that happens, you get something called an ion pair. So we went from 8 ions, or 8 particles, down to 7 particles. That explains the effect. As the solution gets less concentrated, you go to approaching the theoretical value according to the number of ions. The more concentrated the solution is, the greater probability of having ion pairs. What's the name of this? Magnesium sulfate. How many ions are in it? That's your limiting value. Let's see. So those values are approaching 2. Now the reason why it starts off so low compared to sodium chloride, you've got 2 extra things going on in magnesium sulfate. One, you got a 2 plus and a 2 minus charge. Higher charge. Greater probability because of the attractive forces of ion pairs. And you got a size issue. The ions are larger. So both of those contribute to the smaller values of I. What's the name of this? Potassium sulfate. How many ions are in potassium sulfate? That's your limiting value. it's approaching 3. You got 2 potassiums, 1 sulfate, total of 3. Okay, so to do a brief summary, if it's a non-electrolyte, this value of I is 1. If it's an electrolyte, then the limiting value is equal to the number of ions in the ionic compound. Now we can modify some of the formula we've used so far. Here's the freezing point depression, boiling point elevation, and osmotic pressure formula. So if you have your value of I, as I just explained, you can then put that value of I into each one of these formula, like this. And that's how we take into consideration dissociation for electrolytes. We put in this value of I. You know, we've actually been doing this right along. I just didn't say anything. And that's because up until this point, we were talking about non-electrolytes and the value of I was 1.